Okay, thank you. Thank you for the invitation to speak today. This is where I work, spend most of my time, which is the English Institute of Sport, and we are the body that provides their sports medicine and sports science support to the majority of our Olympic and Paralympic athletes. But prior to my role with working in the Institute of Sport, I worked for 15 years in professional rugby, and that's where my interest in the shoulder came about. So, rugby. I had a quick look and see how popular rugby was in Switzerland. The data says you've got 5,000 players and 26 clubs, so that might be some information that you didn't know. And if you're enthused by my presentation, I would advise you to find one of those 26 clubs and increase the numbers of participation. So what is rugby? Okay. So one definition is it's a game played by men with odd-shaped balls. Okay, and that's quite an old definition, because historically was men. But now, okay, we've got women, okay, and we've got professional game, we've got full-time professional women players in the game. But it's not just men, it's odd-shaped men. Okay, so all these players here, okay, all play in the same team. And their specific shapes are advantageous to the positions that they play on the pitch. So one of the problems we've got here, there isn't a generic rugby player. We've got to think about the position that they're playing and the specific skills they need. And with that in mind, we need to think of the specific skills, ranges of motion and strength that their shoulders need. Similar for the women. Obviously, couldn't get the women to take the shirts off for a photograph, but trust me, you can see, okay, there's some different shapes amongst there. But it starts very young, okay, it's about five years of age, we have tag rugby. So they start out like this, lovely little cherubs running around, okay, and they develop into monsters like this. Okay. This is one of the French players, okay, and he's twice the weight of that guy who's just retired as a Welsh international wingers. So on the pitch, you have large disparity, okay, between size and weight, okay, going into collisions, as well as difference in speeds. So if you're not sure what rugby is, we know that most their shoulder injuries occur within the tackle. So 49 to 72% of shoulder injuries occur in the tackle. And here's a few examples of why that might happen.
Heinz Kosef. That's the biggest hit of the season so far.
Jason Taylor has been one of those.
I will leave it there. I don't want to put you off if you were thinking of playing rugby after my introduction. Okay, that's some of the extreme tackles. So in the English Rugby Union, we've been quite proactive since about 2005 of auditing the data of injuries in rugby since the game went professional. And the latest published research, okay, from the 2015-16 season, shows that the likelihood of getting any injury, so this is any injury during a match, okay, is about 62 injuries per 1,000 hours of match play. Okay, so that's in our top league, the Premier League. Okay, and the average severity, okay, the time that somebody would be out with any injury, okay, was about 29 days. So again, we're thinking about a professional game and the costs to the club of losing players for time. But what's important is 49% of all the match injuries sustained, okay, were in the tackle. So many years ago, that's what set me off along my research journey, trying to work out, okay, why did we get so many shoulder injuries in rugby? And some of the early data, so this was the first lot of data that came out from the injury audit, which sparked my interest, is, okay, if we look at training injuries, pretty low, but still a substantial, nearly a month out, okay, of training or playing. But again, 19% of those shoulder injuries, okay, these are the shoulder injuries, were recurrence. And that means that any time, 5% of your playing squad would be unavailable. Again, cost issues to the club. When we look at match day injuries, okay, from here, again, much higher, okay, actually less time in absence, but again, high recurrence rates, okay, with a similar amount of the squad unavailable. Okay, so there's not much we can do about what goes on in match play, but are there things we can do? Are there things we could have done during training where we've got a little bit more control of what goes on that may reduce the incidence of shoulder injuries? And this is where my research started. So I'll give you just a bit more data because of the background from there. So this is a big game. Bledisloe Cup is New Zealand versus Australia. Big game, a bit like probably Norway playing anybody local at handball from there. But if you look at the collision, so not just tackle, running into each other, 500 a game, 270 tackles, with the average tackles per person being 20 tackles per person. Okay, rugby league, which is a 13-a-side game, that's a 15-a-side game, rugby union, 13-a-side, 111 tackles per game, of an average of 25 tackles per person to game. And when we talk about the forces, we need to think about the number of tackles per person. Again, the latest data shows that what we get mostly, okay, to the person who is carrying the ball has been tackled, okay, around the now is AC joint injuries, and similar when we look at the person tackling from there. So there's been, okay, a steady number of shoulder injuries. We haven't changed it drastically, okay, between audits. And one of the things I want to get that I spoke about yesterday in the debate, but he's talked of a contact sport, but Vince Lombardi, when he was talking about American football, okay, said, okay, that football is not a contact sport. Okay, dancing's a contact sport. Okay, rugby's a collision sport, and that's the difference. Okay, the point of the game is smashing into somebody. Okay, from there, it's a key aspect of the game. And, you know, people talk about soccer, football being a contact game. That's not a contact game at all. That is dancing, okay, from there. So when we start to think about some of the recorded impact forces, okay, around the shoulder, okay, at the tackle, we've got massive values, okay, from there. We've got, okay, one and a half, twice times the body weight, okay, at the collision from there. So if we think about the average player is about 101 kilograms, okay, and the average number of tackles that they do is 22, okay, then the total force during a game that shoulder is experiencing, okay, is 21,000, nearly 22,000 newtons, okay. And if we look at some data, some biomechanical data, okay, he says that 5 kilonewtons, okay, would have exceeded the injury thresholds for both the shoulder and the AC joint. So it's amazing we don't get even more shoulder injuries in rugby when we look at these types of forces, okay, overcoming the static forces of the tissues around the shoulder. Again, 13-man game at rugby league, some of the collision forces reported, which were quite high, okay, were 14G, okay, going into that, okay. That's like being in a fighter plane, accelerating off. In rugby union, not quite as high in this. But this data from one international team, so from the Irish team, okay, had some data, okay. This tackle here, 30.5 Gs in that tackle, okay, and in that one there, 33.5 Gs. Incredible, incredible forces. Okay, they only act over a fraction of the time, but those forces, okay, over prolonged time would kill somebody. Okay, if we did that, if we put you and accelerated you at 30 G for 10 seconds, it probably would kill you from there. So what are the risk factors? So one of the things we need to look at is if we know what the risk factors are, maybe we can moderate that and reduce the likelihood of getting an injury. Well, so some of the research shows that older players, okay, who are a bit chubby, okay, a bit overweight, okay, who play in the second half and have had a previous shoulder injuries are at risk. So this was distilled out of the RFU injury data. So what we've got to do is stop players getting older. Okay, stop players getting fatter. Okay, substitute all the players in this for the second half of the game, okay, and retire them once they've had a shoulder injury. And I reckon that that will bring our injury shoulder injury statistics down. Some of the other things we've got there, if you are slow, okay, and you've got poor aerobic capacity, you're more likely to get injured. So again, okay, keep them training well. But this is one of the interesting things, and some of the research that we did sort of picked this up as well, that past injuries have an influence on subsequent injuries. And that's just local around the shoulder, but there's some data actually from football, from soccer, that Joe Gibson's group did, that showed that about 10 professional soccer players from the Premiership in the UK who had shoulder dislocations in the previous 6 months had had a lower limb injury that kept them out of the game. So again, that influence of the kinetic chain is important. And then this is quite interesting as well from some of the stuff that we did. Past injuries obviously alter motor control and balance. And we've got to think about that psychological readiness for them to go back. So quite a lot to think about. So this is one of the first studies we did. We decided to look around the tackle and what went on around the tackle, because nothing had really been looked at around the tackle. So we thought we'd look at the shoulder joint position sense, proprioception around the shoulder in players, rugby players who had never had a shoulder injury that had kept them out of training or playing, and then some age max control, so some students at the university. Okay, and then what we did found is that uninjured rugby shoulders have got better, okay, more reliable proprioception than non-injured, non-playing rugby shoulders around there. But also, when we looked at some of the previous rugby players who had injured shoulders greater than 6 months ago that had been returned to play and had had no problem since, we found that they still had decreased joint position sense 6 months down the line. So maybe the reason for this reoccurrence of the shoulder problem within rugby was due to proprioception. So we thought, right, let's have a look and see, does the tackle have an effect on shoulder proprioception? So we simulated, there's a tackle bar against a post. We set the rugby player up in that position. They had one step back and then hit. Okay. And what we did was we repeated that. We did 10 hits. And again, we assessed their joint position sense. So we had a joint reposition error, so they were supine. We used a mid-range position of external rotation, about 45 degrees, and then about 80 degrees of external rotation. And we looked at them able to reproduce that and match that task from there. So when we looked at mid-range, okay, from there, there wasn't much significant difference. So it didn't change their joint position sense in mid-range. But outer range, there was a significant change, okay, in joint position sense. And if we think about what we're doing, we know, you know, we talk constantly about this ABA position being an unstable position for the joint. So just how much more unstable is it, okay, when your proprioceptive system's not working and delaying your feed forward and stability mechanism around there? And that's the sort of the position that you get into when you're tackling. Again, and that was quite interesting for us from there. So we had an MSc student, so that's part of my PhD work here. About a few years later, one of the MSc students thought, right, we'll do it a little bit more dynamic, though. Rather than hitting a static object, we got them to run a circuit and hit something from there. And it showed the same, okay, values, but okay, with a little bit of a change. So on the non-dominant shoulder, we found a change in mid-range joint position sense. And in the dominant shoulder, okay, in outer range, okay, we found a change. So again, proving that when we get into this, the tackle position, okay, is more likely to make us an unstable shoulder from there. And then another MSc paper that we've not written up yet from there, we timed how long it took, once they'd lost joint position sense, to come back to normal, to the pre-tackling level. And at 15 minutes, it still hadn't normalized. We cut off testing at 15 minutes from there. So it had still not normalized after 15 minutes. So remember, athletes, rugby players are doing up to 22 tackles a game. Okay, and it takes longer than 15 minutes to normalize your proprioception from there. So it's highly likely in the repetitive nature of the game that their proprioception is going to be poor on the subsequent tackles. And then we thought, let's have a look at what muscles work around the shoulder. So we used surface EMG. It was decided that it wouldn't get ethical approval to stick needles into people while they were running into each other. So we same position, okay, stuck EMG on, okay, and we thought we'd look at the onset timing. So we weren't bothered about strength. We want to talk about the stability. We know that we have that pre-setting phase within joints that gives us stability. And we were thinking, right, that's better. A stable joint, okay, we'll get that pre-activation. So when we looked at our cohort of players around there, we found that we got sort of consistent, okay, firing. So in order, it was serratus first, okay, lat dorsi second, okay, infraspinatus third, bicep brachii fourth, and pec major fifth. And while we were doing this, we had five outliers when we looked at this that were consistently different to the rest of them. And when we went on to further examination, we ended up having an arthroscope, and all five of those had a slap lesion. So that was really, really useful for us because we wouldn't have been able to test them, get them through ethics if we knew they had a slap lesion, but they turned up and they said they had no shoulder problems. And when we looked at their EMG, okay, from there, we saw that there's a trend towards delay in activation, okay, of biceps and the other muscles, okay, and an earlier onset of serratus anterior. So serratus seems to work a little bit quicker to try and get the scapula into a more optimal position, and that delay in biceps, okay, and whether or not we believe that bicep is an anterior stabilizer in this position could have an effect on that repeated control around the joint. So if we're thinking about our return to play, and this is some of Claire's stuff around there, but we think it's not just return to play. Okay, we get them return to participation, to return to training. Okay, return to playing, but at a lower level, but their return to performance, playing back at that elite level. So if you look at a lot of studies, they end at their return to play. Okay, often a lot of elite athletes are never monitored when they're playing right at back at the top again. And if it does, you sometimes see that players never actually get back to that level. And then we've got Schreier looking at our return to play decisions. Now, we've all seen this, but what I want to say is we've got to look at modifiable risk factors. So these are what we can modify, definitely. These are what we can possibly modify, but these, okay, we can't modify that. So again, it depends on where we are and what we can do, okay, and how much influence we have on our coaching staff and where we are in the season. So again, a little bit more detail on that. So the framework that I tend to use now when I'm going with any shoulder, but certainly with our contact shoulders from there, is sort of burrowed out. I work with this group of people now. The School of Calisthenics do some great stuff for conditioning up the whole body, but just using body weight. And this is part of their algorithm that we use when we're trying to set up a rehab program or a training program. So we've got to look at the different portions. So if we look at the muscular portion, so we think about the optimal length tension relationship, so our muscles are working well, okay, from there. All right, so we need to make sure that the scapula is in a nice position. It needs to be in an optimal position, an upwardly rotated position, so the length tension relationship's right, and so that we're getting economical muscle recruitment from there. We need to think about the neural component. Okay, so we need to think of the balance between the front and the back of the cuff, the top and the bottom of the cuff. But also, we need to think about, we've talked several times today, about the scapula and the balance of the scapula. If you haven't got a balanced, stable scapula, then your cuff's not going to work very, very well from there. And then we just need to think about the joints themselves. So we talk about roll, spin, and glide, but one of the joints that we tend to neglect a lot around the shoulder is the SC joint. It's hugely important. It's the only place where the upper limb is attached to the skeleton from there. If this doesn't function, the scapula, the clavicle doesn't function. If the clavicle doesn't function, the scapula doesn't function, and that has effects on the subacromial space. And we'll integrate that all together so that we get beautiful, effortless movement. That's what we're looking for, something that's pain-free. So now, just so we finish, we're going to go through just a few other selected exercises that we might use here. So again, in this position, this abduction external rotation, we've got a resistive band. This is a piece of kit that they use for conditioning baseball players in the States that I got when I was over there. And we're just using some reactive work. Okay. So I'm putting it under tension, he's relaxed, and then when I let go, he's got to react in that position. So again, not early on, but towards the end stage. I've left a lot of the early stuff as we get into that. So we keep repeating it. Okay, the main thing is that they have to react to that. Again, this is why we're thinking about our feed forward and where our proprioception comes in. Then this is a great piece of kit. So all this is, I'm not very manual at all. This is the only thing I've ever made. It's a piece of drain pipe that's 2 meters long with 1 liter of water in it and capped off at the end. So that weighs just over 1 kilogram. Okay, so now we're going to do something. So I hate bench press. I don't like it at all. I don't think it's useful. I think it causes more injuries than it ever cures. So in a safe position on the floor, we've got an athlete doing bench press. He thinks he's doing bench press, but this is a perturbation. Can you see how he's having to fight? Because if he's not level, the water runs down to one end and you overcorrect and you go to the other. And you can use that for any test. 1 kilogram, so there's very little load at all. So it's safe to work early on, and we know we need that proprioceptive response. A bit later on here again, doing some bench pressy stuff again. What we've got here is a blue power band and a red power band. We've got a 12 kilogram dumbbell and a 10 kilogram dumbbell. So we've got bands that stretch at different rates and different weights. And we're getting him to do something that he likes. But again, this is a perturbation challenge. You can see, okay, look how all his body's going, okay, through there to create, okay, transfer that force up there. Oh, right, this turns the right way. So here we've got a Swiss ball, again, filled it. It's got 1 liter of water, weighs a kilogram. Okay, this is one of our para athletes. So it's next to the wall, not touching the wall, and all Sarah's got to do is just raise the ball up above her head. But it becomes a massive challenge for her. Okay, because she hasn't got control, and the less control she's got, the more it wobbles around, and you can see how angry she's starting to get and how bad her technique's getting from there. But when we think about rugby, at the point of impact, you've got to be as stiff as anything. That EMG results show that just prior to making contact, that the muscles we looked at all activate and basically pull the humeral head onto the glenoid. So they stiffen up and make that joint rigid for that 30G possible hit that they get. So again, this is a nice exercise that around the shoulder, but a little bit of kinetic chain. So we're not getting, at this point, whole body rigidity. We're getting some dynamic stability at the shoulder joint. So, Turkish get up, just keep
your elbow to the ceiling, that's it, good. Now keep it up, keep your elbow straight, up.
Okay, so it's a really nice challenge, okay, and you have to be able to control the rest here. Again, here, we call this shoulder snugging, so getting the cuff to pull the ball into the socket, okay, and then it's a test for you as a therapist, okay, can you squat your patient, okay, from there. But the idea is that they don't elevate the shoulder, they don't protract or retract. We want them to be able to get the cuff to really hold that ball in the socket. As we talked about a little bit, the force that comes from the shoulder, 80% of the force comes from elsewhere. We get 50% from the sort of waist down, 30% from the trunk, and only 20% from local. So we need to think about the influence of the trunk for producing power, but also we need to think about the mobility of the joints within the kinetic chain. So now we're thinking about rugby and we're thinking about passing. Okay, so we've broken down the task a little bit here. And what we've got? We've got a resistance band around Will's waist and a resistance band around his shoulder to facilitate, as you do, his trunk, pelvic rotation and shoulder rotation to get a pass.
Okay, so if you go.
So again, and we give him a ball, okay, to make it, give it objective concordance so it feels like he's doing something useful.
One more, drive him and shoulder.
From there. Okay, and then here we just gone back and just got him to get him to put his hips round. So training the chain to be functional. Now I really like this, it's a power ball. Okay, so it's a 4 or however much you want med ball on the end of the rope, and this really does test your ability to recruit the kinetic chain. So if you watch Will here, he starts off quite well, and then he starts using his arms. And when he starts to just use his arms, he loses control. But the idea is, as you're going to channel up the movement there, through there and then back. You have to move quickly. You have to keep that rope taut or else it goes slack. And when we do it in this position here, okay, starts to hit you on the head. So you can see as soon as Will just starts using his arms, okay, he's no control. He's really, really fighting it. And that's really, really good in training that transfer in your kinetic chain. And then just a little bit more about the specifics of tackling. So we're going to do an isometric sort of hold as he steps forward in a tackle position. We're going to give a bit of a longer lever now. So can you snug that shoulder into the joint while you're going forwards? Okay, we think about, okay, as you come up, when you're tackling and coming up, can you oppose that force that's driving you down? So again, power band under the foot. Okay, stay in that position. Okay, and then now going down, okay, not having your arm pulled down. So again, we're just teaching that snugging into there. That's what we want. Okay, moving from that. And then this is something that I've messed about with it. So we think when we looked at the EMG of biceps, so we know that in the tackle, you've got biceps doing two things. Okay, it's probably up here stabilizing the anterior part of the shoulder, but it also works at the elbow. Okay, because as you tackle, you grab. So we're trying to teach that. So we've got laid on a bench, okay, elbow support on a bench, an appropriate weight. Okay, and what Lee's going to do here, he's going to monitor the position of his humeral head so he doesn't get an anterior glide. And we've done a lot of stuff about positional control with him here. So we want him to go out, okay, into, okay, full elbow extension and control that position. Okay, so a bit of function. It's a good for rehabilitating biceps. And then we make it a little bit more unstable, so my hands are not holding the ball, they're just there in case it starts to move. So again, same thing, control the humeral head, but it's a little bit more unstable. And then finally, okay, this is really, really, you choose your patients carefully with this one. Yeah, so we have no support here. Oh, sorry, we're doing this one. So this is really nice for you as a physio. Get them to stand like that. And as they bend forward, you get them to say, I am not worthy.
And then you go, what do you say?
Okay, either stand there and go, I am not worthy. At the end of a long day, it feels great. But this one here, so again, massively challenging. Okay, massively challenging. You've got to select your patient appropriately for that. So when we're thinking about having a rigid body, when there, but again, we need to be able to move our head at contact. We don't want to be stiff because we need to move our head when we're tackling. We know if you get your head in the wrong position when you're tackling, that's when you get concussion, neck injuries, and shoulder injuries. So what we're doing here, okay, we're starting to do some dynamic movement, okay, around a rigid trunk. So we've got some movement around the shoulder while we've got a rigid trunk. And here we're just working through getting some controlling scapular upward rotation, and that lift is driven from the scapula. We're saying to the athlete, think of your shoulder going round, it's your shoulder blade that is elevating your shoulder. So into here now, so yes, hold a plank position, but I want freedom of movement at your neck because you need to be able to move your head and look while you're making a tackle. Okay, and if we really, really want to test them, okay, we can get them into handstand position. And again, that ability to not be rigid through your neck and move around. And a lot of stuff like this is what we do with a school of calisthenics from there, using body weight, and it's pretty safe. So we're nearly there. So we have to do some things, okay, and there isn't a validated return. So we try and replicate and gradually load the shoulder. So we start off, okay, in a closed chain position. And we get them doing a little bit of wheelbarrowing, so walking forwards, okay, getting crabbing sideways, so we're getting them to weight bear into abduction, into adduction across the body. Okay, and we're testing the shoulder, and we're looking that they're able to do that, support that, and they're not getting any pain. And something like Marty's talked about, do some plyo push-ups, okay, looking at the ability to generate, but also accept load. And then we have to do something that's a bit rugby specific. So early on, we just get them just to hit with the shoulder off a couple of steps into a bag, and we change that up with more steps and more power. And then to finish with, one of the things we start to do is just get them. One, can they do a handstand? Are they happy to load? Okay, at the end of elevation, and we'll get them to roll over onto their arms. And there's lots of steps in between that. So here we go. So what I think is, if somebody's got a rugby shoulder problem or any shoulder problem, act local, but think global. Okay, don't forget the kinetic chain and that 80% of their force comes from a kinetic chain, but also that requirement, that alternating requirement at the joints of mobility and stability as we go up there. There's still a load we don't know about the rugby shoulder. And we talked a lot about screening, but there's no screening in the world's going to prevent a shoulder injury when you're smashing into each other, okay, at the equivalent of a 30 mile an hour car crash around there, apart from if you're quicker and nobody can catch you for tackling around there. And I would say about everything, but we need to look at proprioception. I think it's a thing we miss around in the upper limb and the shoulder. We do lots of things in the lower limb, just getting people to balance on one leg with their eyes open and their eyes closed. But very rarely do we assess proprioception in the lower limb. And we say we need to develop some further understanding of the rugby shoulder. And after 8 years of work, this was the conclusion from my PhD, and it's not particularly rocket science, so it does show in the UK they'll give you a PhD for anything from there. Okay, but after all, okay, some shoulder injuries will never be prevented. Thank you very much.